The December 6th edition of Lunch with Lincoln starts now. I am staff director for the Lincoln Project. Today, I am in for Reed Galen, and we are super lucky to have a very good friend of mine and probably the guy who knows the most about Florida politics on the planet, Peter Schorsch with Florida Politics with us. Thanks for being here, Peter.
Ryan, so good to hear from you. Congratulations on your promotion to staff director. I'm looking forward to seeing what you do with the cruise ship.
Thank you. Yeah, the pirate ship is always a fun thing, full of a merry band of misfits. And so we are excited looking into 2022, and it is going to be fun to be leading that team. So we want to talk about Florida, because Florida is like the super sexy topic that everyone wants to talk about, because sure, we are out of control and Florida man is running our state. So let's get into it. I want to talk about, you know, Peter, you and I have both worked on campaigns. And typically when you are doing a campaign, especially in a purple state like Florida, a candidate will go pretty far onto their side of the spectrum before bringing it back in to be more moderate for the general. They're trying to fire up their base and get them to show up for the primary. So we've seen Ron DeSantis go pretty far to the right. Do you think it is possible for him to bring it back to the middle? And if he does, do you think the Floridians are going to buy it right now?
All right, so that's a multi-prong question there. I don't think he is interested in bringing it back to the middle. And that's one of the real tragedies of Ron DeSantis, is that, you know, the first 18 months, the beginnings of his term in office before the pandemic, this was a governor who was, a 2-to-1 governor. He was somebody that had basically 2-to-1 job approval rating. Sometimes it was up in the 60s. And he slowly lost that. And now he's a 50-50 governor. Now, Florida is, you know, probably a center right state by a couple points right now. So it's okay to be, Republicans have dominated for over 20 years now. He's, you know, he knows that all he has to do is turn out basically the same numbers that he did before. I believe that the smart people around him who have been polling for him have told him that there are more and more Republicans moving in. You know, people are leaving Staten Island and Youngstown, Ohio, and they're tired of the libs and they're moving down to Fort Myers. And, you know, they see Florida as this, you know, the free state of Florida, that it's the Casablanca for Republicans. And so they've moved down here. And I think he thinks that, hey, all I have to do is turn out my base. And my base, as Donald Trump showed, you know, huge, big 3.5% victory over Biden in Florida. All, you know, he has to do is turn that out. You know, unfortunately, though, I think, you know, that it really does turn everything into a divisive issue, which is, you know, it's just really where I come from. I'm such a centrist that I get run over all the time. I'm in the middle of the road. I'm not always critical of Ron DeSantis. Like, I've been, you know, I've given him credit, you know, especially on his choice to have in-person education. Early on in the pandemic, I was very supportive of some of the stuff that he's done. But he is just, his whole administration now is set up to own the libs, whether it be his choice of Surgeon General, whether it be his choice of communication staffers, you know, his constant aggrievement that he displays at each press conference. It's always about, he never says President Biden, it's always about Biden. It's always about what New York is doing. It's always about how evil California is. I don't know, in a state of 21.5 million people, you know, an overwhelming majority of those people are not Republican, whether they be Democrat or independents. And it becomes grating at some point where you're just like, please, can we have some, I don't know, some Charlie Crist, Jeb Bush centricism at this point?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think you look and DeSantis won by like 32,000 votes. It was not a lot. And he's lost that many people to COVID, more than that many people to COVID. And so you wonder, like, did you kill off your own base here, man? Like, I agree with you. I think that it is an interesting look. You know, the first 2 years that he was governor before the pandemic, before we got into, you know, the presidential stuff. You know, I was surprised, like pleasantly surprised. I mean, he did some, you know, pro LGBTQ legislation and, you know, and where did that guy go?
He pardoned the Groveland Four, you know, that was a big thing. You know, there was the famous press conference that he had with Matt Gaetz and John Morgan on medical marijuana. He has always had a strong record on the environment. He continues to have a strong record on environmental funding. Ryan, I don't say this lightly, and I wish I had more proof of it. And it makes me sound, I don't know, like I'm kind of like a blue and non person, or that I am who DeSantis' spokesperson, Christina Pushaw, says people are when they have DeSantis derangement syndrome. I genuinely think he was mentally impacted by the pandemic, much like so many of us in America and Florida were, by the isolation, by the stress of it all. Do I think he went batshit crazy? No. But do I think that a year of more isolation than he's probably had to deal with, even as governor, in a town that he really doesn't have, you know, DeSantis doesn't have a lot of people. Like, that's always been the book on him. Like, you know, you read the Politico articles, you read the great Adam Smith profile of him. This isn't a guy with a huge social circle. In fact, Ryan, I find it still very interesting. Follow his Twitter. Friday nights, he's going to high school football games. That's great. That's awesome to see the governor at the Merritt Island high school football game. What that also tells me is there's nobody in Tallahassee that he wants to go and do a dinner party with. There's no close advisor there. There's no like senior staff hanging out at the governor's mansion. He's literally, you know, it's him and Casey, the kids, and that's it. I think a lot of that got to him. And I think, quite honestly, it's like the reverse Grinch thing. I think his heart grew three sizes too small.
Well, I think that's a really, really, really powerful point. And talking about this, let's talk about these culture wars that, you know, you and I are kind of touching on a little bit. DeSantis and Greg Abbott kind of seem to be in a race to the bottom on this. And how do you think that that's going to impact a more establishment-based legislature? I mean, you know, the Florida legislature is very right. And it may even be, I know it's a supermajority in the House. I don't know that it is in the Senate, but it's very right-leaning. But they've always been more establishment-oriented, not so nationalistic. Authoritarianism. How do you think this impacts them when they go back to their districts, especially in the area where you live, like in the Tampa Bay area that is notoriously moderate, and I-4 is the bellwether for Florida? How does that impact the members who have to go back and sell that agenda to their constituents?
We're the notorious mods over here. I do feel like living in where I live, St. Petersburg, Florida, it is just so, it's so special still. In the mm-hmm. sense, like Pinellas County, Hillsborough, the last battlegrounds in the most battlegroundy state. It's I guess it's like where the end of the war is going to happen, you know, for control of Florida. If anybody ever wants to study politics, there's just more money, more competitive races around within 30 miles of me than there is throughout the rest of the state. I mean, it's sure. amazing how that works out. You know, it hasn't impacted the Republican legislature. I think that that's a point that I try to make to people again and again, is that these folks are elected in primaries, these Republican legislators. And, you know, because of how much money is there, how much, I don't want to say gerrymandering, because that's not really the case in the Senate, but these folks are elected in the primary. They are elected by, you know, folks at the Republican, you know, the Lincoln Day dinners, you know, and those people are upset about immigration and Hunter Biden's laptop, et cetera. They think that they are doing their constituents' bidding. Don't make the mistake to think that they're not responsive. That's who is electing these folks. These folks are not having to go through general election contests for the most part. you know, again and again, these people are elected. And then they, when they, we have term limits in Florida, for anybody who doesn't know, they almost, if you get in that first year, rarely is an incumbent unseated in that first 8 years. Now, I will say, you know, and it's hard to like show the sausage that's not made. But I believe that the legislature, especially in the Senate, has been a moderating force on a lot of the legislation that DeSantis has wanted to propose. Now, it's hard to prove a double negative, but I know from talking to the senior staff there and some of the lawmakers, you know, DeSantis will have a press conference. He'll say he wants to do one thing. This just happened on the special session where he wanted to, you know, ban vaccine mandates and so forth. By the time it gets to the legislature, but and a lot of this is closed doors and stuff like that. By the time the legislation actually passes the House and Senate, I don't want to say it's moderate, but it is moderated down substantially. And then thirdly, you know, one thing that's happened, and it's a real big trend here. We just saw this again with the Seminole Compact, the sports betting arrangement that just got struck down. You know, DeSantis loses a lot in court, especially on the legislative side. You know, they passed a bill earlier this year that was going to limit the amount of money that was spent on referendums. It was called the so-called John Morgan bill, that you weren't going to be able to put millions of your own money in to pass medical marijuana or a minimum wage amendment, et cetera. That got struck down. A lot of the voting rights stuff gets struck down. He's tied up in a lot of court cases on the anti-riot legislation, et cetera. So a lot of his signature issues get struck down, and not just by liberal courts. These are mostly Republican-appointed courts, but they, you know, they just look at the bills and they realize that these are things that don't pass constitutional muster. So between a little bit of the legislature and a little bit of the courts, a lot of Ron DeSantis's worst impulses get moderated out.
That's awesome. I mean, that's good news for the country as a whole. You know, that's how the system of checks and balances is supposed to work. Legislative session starts in a month. So what are we going to see? I mean, we've already have seen that there's a bill that's out there that's trying to make school board races partisan. And I haven't looked to see if there's a companion in the Senate there. But, you know, we've seen, you know, the threat of a heartbeat bill, and we've seen the House put someone in charge of judiciary, which will be a major stop for that bill, who has made her entire legislative career about right to life. And we have a president of the Senate who is in the same kind of place. Are we looking at a session that's going to be dominated by these culture wars? What are we going to see coming out of it? What's going to pass? What's not going to pass?
Well, the first and foremost is redistricting. And that does suck up a lot of, thank God for redistricting.
Yes.
Because redistricting is going to probably stop a lot of the things that you're talking about. If we weren't in a redistricting year, I do think you would see some of these, just atrocious bills, you know, go forward. The abortion, the anti-abortion bill. I think they want to take another bite at the apple on transgender student athletes. You know, a lot of these things, you know, again, they get proposed, they get the headlines, and then they never find the light of day. Wilton Simpson, who is the agriculture, or who's running for agriculture commissioner, is the Senate president now. He really does not want to be in Tallahassee that much. He's a farmer. He doesn't like being on Tallahassee over the weekends. I think that he's slowing down the momentum. I think that there's so much difference between the two chambers on their redistricting proposals that is, again, that's going to eat up a lot. Another thing that's probably playing in like the favor of blocking some of this other stuff because of momentum is there's a lot of money. There's not years when there's not a lot of money, you get focused on these social issues. There's Florida's tax revenue is doing so well. There's so much money coming down from the federal government that kind of washes away a lot of the sins. You know, and then also I do think, you know, going into 2022, I don't think DeSantis, I don't think Wilton Simpson, I don't think some of these lawmakers that are going to be running in new seats, et cetera, I don't think that they want to be, you know, tagged with this anti-abortion bill. I know that there's a lot of consternation about this. I you know, you kind of like, you think about the Gangs of New York metaphor about, you know, the world changes underneath your feet and you don't feel it. I really do think that there is a possibility if they strike down Roe v. Wade, or they, you know, severely handicap that, and Florida passes you know, the anti-abortion legislation that came out of Texas, which I don't think that it will. But if they, you put those two together, that's kind of where you get like a change election out of it. Like, I do think that that would energize a whole segment of the population that may have been sitting on the sidelines the last couple of elections.
So that you think they're going to stay away from some of that, and that redistricting is going to basically make it impossible to pass some of that. Thank goodness.
It will eat up a lot of the oxygen in the room.
Good. Let's talk a little bit about redistricting. You know, in 2010, that was a big deal in Florida. And, you know, there was all talk of gerrymandering, and it went through all the courts, and it was just a really, really ugly situation. Democrats were not happy with the maps. Right now, the things I'm reading, the Democrats seem okay with what staff is putting together. I mean, do you think that stays? Do you think that holds tight? Do you think that this goes back to the courts?
You know, it's very interesting. You say 2010. Remember, they didn't get done till 2016.
Yeah, I was going to say it lasted the whole time.
This is the year that lasted a decade. Mm-hmm. Wilton Simpson, you know, again, the best thing going for a lot of people is that Wilton Simpson just doesn't want to deal with a lot of these headaches. And especially, he wants a nice slam dunk right into becoming agriculture commissioner, sets up a nice spot for him running for governor in 2024 or something like that after DeSantis does his presidential thing. You know, so I think he sees the long term. And so he's trying to avoid some of this stuff. You know, the thing about redistricting, I do have to tell people that are paying attention to like Florida, you know, the lines that you see now were basically Democratic lines. They were drawn by Barbara Pariente, a Supreme Court justice who was, you know, very left-leaning. The Republicans did screw around. I don't think that they want to go through that again. They don't want to do, they seem very serious about not letting in the people, some of the people you and I know and have worked with in the past. You know, there's always the consultant slips you a file with the perfect map. Mm-hmm. And how does that get it? I don't think that there's going to be as much of that this time. Now, the big fight between right now is, so the Senate came up with maps that were, you know, judged by even outside officials, the Princeton gerrymandering project, et cetera. To be good. They were given B grades. Then the House came out with its maps and they were given F grades. I think what happened was DC called down to the Speaker's office and said, hey, I don't know what's going on with these Senate maps, but they're too fair to Democrats. We need, you know, the delegation is going to be 28 House members next time. We need a 17 to 11 or 18 to 10 delegation out of there to help get Kevin McCarthy across the finish line. You know, the Senate was coming forward with a 16-12. I actually thought it was more like a 15-13. And I think somebody got taken to the principal's office there.
No, that makes sense. I mean, and it's not surprising that Florida House is the one that came out with the more radicalized maps.
It's weird because the guy that we don't like the least, this Anthony Sabatini guy, who's just the worst of the worst of the worst, just total pond scum of a legislator out of Lake yes. County. He was actually given a pathway to replacing Stephanie Murphy in Congress, given a safe seat. I just can't believe that anybody up in Tallahassee wants to give that guy, who has called the president of the Senate, speaker, everybody, he's called them cucks, he's called them rhinos, any word you can come up with. I can't believe they want to give him a free pass into Congress.
Yes, I agree. I would prefer he not get a free pass into Congress as well. I don't think that we need that up there, speaking from the district that I sit in. So let's talk a little bit about the gubernatorial that's coming up, right?
Yeah.
It's a hot button issue. Everybody wants to know, is DeSantis going to have a path here? And if he does, does that clear the White House for him? So I want to talk about the people who are in this race. I know that, you know, you and your wife are close with Charlie Crist. We have Nikki Fried in that race. What are the pros and cons? And Annette Tadeo is in there too. What are the pros and cons of those three candidates on the Democratic side? And who wins? Who pulls it out in the primary?
All right, I'll give you my one metaphor that I rely on again and again. It's 2007 going into 2008. I was living in New York. The New York Giants had made the playoffs. This is when the Patriots had the 17-0 team. I was living in New York. I was betting on some of the games. The Bucks were playing. The Cowboys were playing. The Packers were playing. The Giants beat each one of them as underdogs. And then they got up to the Patriots. They were 11-point underdogs. I was so in the hole with some of my New York friends that I didn't know if my knees were going to last past Super Bowl Sunday. They weren't even charging me the points on the Giants versus the Patriots because Patriots were going to win so easily. And they wanted the Giants. I couldn't believe that. And then lo and behold, the guy catches the football on his helmet from Eli Manning. And the Giants defeat what was considered the best team maybe of all time at that point. On any given Sunday, the Giants can beat the Patriots. With that scenario, on any given Sunday, it's still Florida. It's still 33,000 votes. Rick Scott only beat Bill Nelson by 11,000 votes. I know the registration numbers have changed a little bit, but it's still Florida. There is a world where Charlie Crist can beat Ron DeSantis just straight up. Do I think that that's what's going to happen as I sit here right now? No, but I do think that there is a path where, DeSantis just continues to alienate people. His poll numbers continue to falter. And Charlie Crist represents maybe the best contrast. He represents an empathetic, candidate, and he somehow gets there. Again, I don't think that that's going to happen. I agree with the prediction markets right now where they have it at Ron DeSantis at about a 75% chance of reelection. But I will say, if you were Charlie Crist, and again, we are close with him. If you were Charlie Crist coming into 2021, here's what you needed to happen. Number one, you would need Nikki Fried to not take off. You would basically need her candidacy to implode. She hasn't imploded, but her candidacy just has not taken off. There's no money there for her. There doesn't seem to be any institutional support for her. Her personal issues continue to dog her. Number two, if I'm Charlie Crist, I needed Ron DeSantis's poll numbers to go down. So if Ron DeSantis came into the year at a 60% plus approval rating, now he's at 48%. That means that over this year, he's dropped a good 10 to 12 points. Charlie Crist needed that to happen. Number three, he needed a black candidate not to emerge. And it looks like a black candidate is not going to emerge and split up the Democratic primary vote. It looks like Crist has rounded up most of the key endorsements, and not just in Tampa Bay, but from, the Audrey Gibsons of Jacksonville, a lot of South Florida. He's picked up most of that endorsement. I think he is, if the race was now, he would probably pick up 70 to 80% of the black vote, which still thinks highly of Charlie from his previous runs. He held open the voting late on Obama's election, even though he was a Republican. There's a lot of goodwill there. So Charlie, if I would just say to my friend, he's done everything he needed to do in 2021 to get here, to be in fighting shape. Now, I still think he's a long shot. Annette Tadeo, Annette's an exciting candidate. I mean, she showed it again this weekend at Florida Blue, the Democrats gathering, that she's a great speaker. She's got a great entrepreneurial attitude. She's got a great message against the socialism argument that Democrats get hit with. Charlie and Annette ran together as a ticket back in 2014. I wish they hadn't then, so that they could come together and run together as a ticket now, because I think that they would be formidable. Nikki Fried, I just think she's a hot mess. I think that she is an extraordinarily intelligent person. I've spoken with Nikki a bunch of times. She is one of the sharpest, knives in the drawer. But, she still has these ethics issues. She still has, she's got this thing. Here's a very small one. She's a medical marijuana card holder. She says she's a concealed weapon permit holder. That's against federal regulations. I'm not saying that it should be, but that's what the rules say. And she just runs into these kind of issues. I'm telling you that the Republicans are just begging for Nikki Fried to get past the primary so that they can Gillum her again in 2022 and use all of Ron DeSantis's, considerable fundraising, what he's brought in, $100 million, probably $150 by the time the general gets here, and just bomb her way at her. So I do think that Crist is still their best chance. I still think that that's a 3-to-1 dog against him. Something major is going to have to change May, June, July for Charlie to be in fighting, to be able to knock off DeSantis.
I think that that's probably spot on, and I hate it. I really do. I hate it because I think that of any time in our state's history, that this was just such a clear race. I mean, you're fighting for democracy. It's like we should all be one issue voters. You know, like you have a guy here who's trying to kind of shut that down. It's been very hard to figure out, you know, how Ron DeSantis is going to continue to claim pro-business, pro-conservative ideals, given the things that he's put in place in response to COVID even. I mean, you know, he's trying to tell businesses how to operate, and it's crazy town. Trying to tell universities and professors when they can work and when they can testify. And it's just crazy town. I have one more question for you. You and I both know one of the big strategies Democrats have used in the past going into midterms, because midterms have notoriously terrible turnout, is to put things on the ballot that will bring people to the polls, the ideas, issues that people do care about, to get them to show up to vote. What are we going to see this year? Last year we saw the attempt to open up primaries, which would have, you know, in theory made our election pool more moderate. I mean, are we going to see that come back up? Are we going to see a push for medical or for recreational marijuana? How are the Democrats going to fire up their base going into 2022?
Okay, so I'll answer that in two parts by saying that the big issue, probably more expensive than even the governor's race, will be the sports betting initiatives if they get on the ballot in Florida. There's two of them right now, Las Vegas Sands and then FanDuel DraftKings. The Seminole Tribe may have one put on there. They're already at the $100 million mark combined and what they're going to raise and spend. I wouldn't be surprised if they get to the $300 million mark by the time they're done in terms of, you know, in commercials and trying to get that passed. It's such a lucrative market. I don't know who that turns out. Quite honestly, it will turn out a lot of people. I will say that there will be, you know, you will have FanDuel vans probably, you know, just driving up and down the street, picking up people, trying to get some, you know, people that have identified that they're pro gambling to get them to the polls. So there will be an overall turnout. I think the thing that the Democrats, the one secret weapon, Ryan, that they have is Val Demings. She delivered another impassioned speech this weekend at the Florida Blue. You can see why she is a rock star. She shocked the world during the last quarter fundraising report. She was the second biggest fundraiser against Marco Rubio. She's got $8 million. So if she can turn out the black vote, she can energize the young vote. And let's say that she's raising enough money to turn, you know, if she raises 50 to 100 million and becomes kind of like a, you know, like a Warnock Ossoff situation in Georgia, maybe Val Demings is enough to lift all the boats in the tide, or however that, I just butchered that metaphor. And you would think somebody living on the water would get that metaphor, right? But if Val Demings may be the Democrats' not so secret weapon going into 2022.
You think she has a real shot against Rubio? She's real?
She's definitely real. I mean, you just, the resume's there, the personality's there, this, you know, the public speaking, she knocked it out of the park this weekend. And now they're telling me the fundraising's real, you know, and you can't go at her with the, you can't go with her against with the defund the police argument, because she was a police chief. You can't go with her that she's not, you know, incredibly, like, I mean, her and her husband have made Orange County one of the best places to live. You know, her husband's the sheriff and then is now the mayor over there. You know, they're such a power couple. So on so, you know, to so many factors, she is the real deal here. It's just, you know, and Rubio, quite honestly, as you and I both know, I mean, Rubio is a lackluster candidate, person, human being, whatever you want to say. You know, I think there's a better shot, quite honestly, of taking out Rubio. You know, look, considering how small the margins were in the last race, it would not surprise me if DeSantis wins by 100,000 votes, but maybe Val Demings beats Rubio by 20,000. You know, that there's maybe that much of a, you know, people, Rubio doesn't excite the Trump base the same way that DeSantis does. So maybe people just leave that one blank. I think that there's a genuine shot for knocking off Rubio.
Peter, thank you so much for taking the time. And everyone should read all of your stuff. Peter puts out this incredible newsletter every morning. It's called Sunburn. You should go. You should subscribe to it. It's where I read it every single morning. It's where I get a huge chunk of my news, especially in Florida-related things. Peter, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today.
Thank you. Michelle says to say hi to you, too.
So. Hey, Michelle. Thank you.